Good morning. Welcome to the 10:02 service at the Union Church of South Foxboro. I walked up here and stood here to start us off, and no one stopped what they were doing. And then Jim played a couple notes, and everybody looked up. We're here to worship the Lord together today. Welcome to those of you who are watching on live stream, including many of our church family and extended church family. Welcome to you also. We're glad to have you joining us. We're going to begin with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you that we may gather in this place today. Thank you that you are present. You are here in this sanctuary. You are present in every home or automobile where we are now. Receive our worship today, we pray, and so touch and work in our hearts and our lives that we will leave here today encouraged to look to you and reminded of your grace and your love for us. We give you thanks today in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. Just a couple announcements to share with you. A reminder that we have a biker blessing on September 10 that's run not by us, but by the Christian Motorcycle Association. But if you have a friend who has a bike and they might like to have it blessed and participate in that, that is next Saturday at 10 a.m. here at the Union Church, September 10 at 10 a.m. Wednesday Bible study is ongoing. We've started the book of Jonah. We set out last Wednesday to do a chapter. We got about an eighth of the way through it. So if you would like to join that, you're not too late. Wednesday nights, we're on Zoom and in person at 7 p.m. Ignite is not meeting tonight. That's our church youth group. We are off tonight for the holiday weekend, the Labor Day weekend. And also, I want to mention on September 17, we have an informational meeting regarding this room, this sanctuary. There's been talk for 20 years about refreshing it in some way. We certainly need a new carpet. And on September 17, some planning and some things that have been researched are going to be made available, the details made available. So that's Saturday night, 7 p.m., September 17. We're going to have desserts and coffee and have a conversation about that. Next, we're going to worship the Lord together in song, and I wanted to read Isaiah 51, 25, verse 1, Isaiah 25, verse 1, which says this, "Lord, you are my God. I will exalt you. I will praise your name. For in perfect faithfulness, you have done wonderful things, things you planned long ago." Let's join together in worship the one as we exalt him who is our God and praise his name. Shall we stand and worship together?
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name. sun's shining down on me when the world's all as it should be. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering. Though there's pain in the offering, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name.
Worship God together today. We're going to worship Him in prayer and express our gratitude and our thanks for who He is and pray for some of the many requests on the hearts of people. And our worship verse today is Isaiah 25, verse 1, which I read a moment ago. Lord, you are my God. I will exalt you. I will praise your name. For in perfect faithfulness, you have done wonderful things, things you planned long ago. Heavenly Father, thank you again that you are present with us this morning. And thank you, Heavenly Father, that we can gather together and we can feel your presence and we can interact with you. And corporately or individually, we can praise your name. For it is true that Isaiah wrote so long ago You are perfect in faithfulness. You have done wonderful things, and you thoughtfully, carefully planned these things from so long, long ago. Heavenly Father, today we worship you. We acknowledge who you are, for you made all things. You created the world for your own pleasure. You created humankind in your own image and likeness. We have fallen before you. We are sinful and imperfect, and we see that on the news. We experience it in our personal life. But for those who will heed, those who will listen, those who will come to the summons of your Holy Spirit, there is recognition that you have sent your Son, Jesus Christ, fully God from all eternity past, with the Father and the Holy Spirit, who came in the form of a man, who walked among us, who spoke words of truth and taught us your ways, and who gave his life as a sacrifice for our sin on the cross, exchanging his holy and sinless life for those of us who are sinful. And by trusting in him and his sacrifice and his work alone, we are forgiven. We are washed clean by the Holy Spirit. We are given a new heart and a new life and a new purpose. And through him, we trust in him and secure through his work, he secures for us eternity in the kingdom of heaven. We worship you today for your holiness, for you are perfect in all your ways. We worship you in your divine majesty. You are majestic beyond our imagination. You are the source of all that is true, all that is morally perfect. You are the source of love that we may have for one another, and you love human beings. You love every human, no matter how desperate, for each one you intentionally made in your own image and likeness. And Father, we exalt you and we worship you and we thank you because you love each and every one of us, those of us watching on live stream, those who are present. You love us. You love every member of our family. You love every person in our friend circle. And we bless you and we thank you for this gift, for we can never repay it. Thank you for the peace you give us when we know Christ and the hope that we have in him, that no matter what we experience in this world, one day it will be behind us and all will be perfect forever and ever in your kingdom. Father, we have a lady in our church family who wishes to remain anonymous, but who is undergoing treatment for cancer. You know who she is. You know everything about her and her family. Father, we pray that treatment would be effective for her health and well-being. We continue to pray for George Sirikas as he is meeting with doctors later in the month to determine his course of treatment. Father, bless him. Guide him, guide the doctors for the right plan. For a friend I've promised to pray for who also has cancer and is having treatment, Father, make it effective, we pray, against difficult odds for his well-being and for the purposes you have in that family, that they would know and love you and have the hope that you give us in Christ. We continue to pray for Dave and Ruth Weber's daughter, Michelle, as she has a series of health issues. We pray, Heavenly Father, that you would continue to give the doctors wisdom and grant Michelle wellness. We pray for a family in Foxborough who lost a young mother her oldest child only in second grade. Father, be with them. Be with those dear children. Be with her husband. Be with all their family, with a grief beyond what we at this moment can even understand. Bless them, we pray. Comfort them. Be with them today, tomorrow, and all the days and years ahead. Father, some of our families, some of our people in our church family are struggling with various issues, division in relationships, struggle with money, struggle with various personal issues. Father, be with each one, for those with unspoken prayer requests, and work mightily, we pray, according to your wisdom. For you are always wiser than we, you always know better than we do. Father, so work, we pray, this very day, and those of us who are gathered here and wherever we may be, that we may trust in you more fully. Show us daily in our life how we may trust you and how you so work. Father, so work within us that we would live a life of obedience to you, in love for you, in service to you. And Father, that others would join our church family and the hope that we have in Christ. Father, help us to share with those around us what you have done for us, that they too may have hope. Be with those in recovery who meet here, we pray. Some are in our families. Some of them are us. Some are in our community, each one precious in your sight. May they see there is hope. May they see there is, in fact, a higher power, Jesus Christ, who cares for them and who is leading them. Father, we worship you today as Jesus taught his disciples to pray. Whose Father? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We're going to be looking in a moment at Hebrews chapter 7, beginning at verse 11. If you want to bring it up on your phone, or you want to follow along in the Bible in the pew that looks exactly like this one, because I borrowed this many years ago from a pew, it's on page 849, Hebrews chapter 7, beginning at verse 11, in just a moment. Hey, I don't want to brag. Sometimes I can't help it. I have a great eye for looking at and finding a really good bargain, getting things for that are quality for the right price. I don't know why, I'm just good at that. Many, many years ago, you may remember Building 19 up on Route 1 in Norwood, and I once went in there and they had pants for sale for $5 each. There were several pairs my size, so I bought them only $5 each. What a great bargain. And I wore them probably three times before they shrunk beyond what I could fit into anymore, but they were a great bargain. Then there was the time I was just driving, minding my own business, and there was a lawnmower on the side of the road. A guy was selling it right off his lawn, and I stopped and I checked it out. You know, he was able to start it. I only paid 10 bucks for it. I never could get it started, but 10 bucks for a lawnmower, it was a great bargain. Then there was a time I bought a tire from a junkyard. You know, it was only $15. They mounted it for me and everything, and I drove away with a really great tire at a really good price. I got a whole mile out of that tire. I had AAA. It all worked out really well. That was a good bargain. And there have been shoes, and there have been shirts, and there have been other pants. There's the jacket still hanging in the closet in the living room, and the snaps sometimes stay snapped for a few minutes on a chilly day. It was a great price. Lots of good bargain items. And you know I'm not alone. A lot of other people have a good eye for a bargain. And a lot of times it's for a spiritual bargain. And all around the world, we see what's available in the spiritual arena that will make us feel better about ourselves, or make us feel as though we have an advantage in the world in which we live, or maybe in some way are affirming to give us a sense of connection with some type of God or gods or higher being. The trouble is, a lot of them turn out to be the bargains that I'm good at finding. It turns out to be a spirituality that's a dead ender, doesn't lead anywhere, or doesn't fill that empty place that God's created in each and every one of us, that only the true God who made all things can fill. Well, the book of Hebrews has been talking about the greatest spirituality we can have, greater than any other, and that is found in the person of Jesus Christ and the work that he has done. He's greater than any other religious leader in all of human history. They lie in the grave, no offense to any, but Jesus Christ rose from the dead and ascended and is sitting at the right hand of the Father. And again through the book of Hebrews, all the book is expounding on the first three verses of the letter to the Hebrews, where the author wrote that Jesus is God's final word, his exact representation, the exact person of who God is, and he is God's word to humanity forever and ever and ever. We need go no other place, no other source, no other spiritual truth. It all originates and is contained in the person of Jesus. And the author has been using, because he's writing to first century Hebrews, the contrast between the law of Moses and the priesthood of Aaron, the priests of Israel, if you don't know, in the Jewish faith, were descended from Aaron, the brother of Moses. But the contrast between those priests and the law of Moses versus the superior priesthood of Jesus Christ and who he was. And last week he talked a lot about Melchizedek, the mysterious figure from Genesis 14, who appeared and had no beginning and no ending and offered a priesthood that was greater than any priest in the Old Testament. And the author said that was a picture of Jesus Christ, a forerunner of Jesus. And he continues the thinking today in Hebrews chapter 7, beginning at verse 11, and I'm going to read from 11 through the balance of the chapter. The author writes, "If perfection could have been attained through the Levitical priesthood, that's of Aaron, for on the basis of it, the law was given to the people, that's through Moses, why was there still need for another priest to come? One after the order of Melchizedek, not the order of Aaron. For when there is a change of the priesthood, there must also be a change of the law. He of whom these things are said belonged to a different tribe," meaning Jesus, "and no one from that tribe has ever served at the altar. For it is clear that our Lord," that's Jesus, "descended from Judah. And in regard to that tribe," meaning the tribe of Judah, "Moses said nothing about priests. And what we have said is even more clear: if another priest like Melchizedek appears, one who has become a priest, not on the basis of regulation as to his ancestry, but the basis of the power of an indestructible life. For it is declared, 'You were a priest forever in the order of Melchizedek.' The former regulation is set aside because it was weak and useless, for the law made nothing perfect, and a better hope is introduced by which we draw near to God. And it was not without an oath. Others became priests without any oath, But he became a priest, meaning Jesus, with an oath when God said to him, "The Lord has sworn and will not change his mind. You are a priest forever." Because of this oath, Jesus has become the guarantee of a better covenant. Now, there has been many of those priests since death prevented them from continuing in office. But because Jesus lives forever, he has a permanent priesthood. Therefore, he is able to save completely those who come to God through him, because he always lives to intercede for them. Such a high priest meets our need. He's the real one, not the counterfeit. One who is holy, blameless, pure, set apart from sinners, exalted above the heavens. Unlike the other high priests, he does not need to offer sacrifices day after day, first for his own sins, then the sins of the people. He sacrificed for their sins once and for all when he offered himself. For the law appoints as high priests men who are weak, but the others came after the law, appointed by the Son, who has been made perfect forever. Now, all through the book of Hebrews, Jesus the rescuer is stressed, Jesus the Savior is stressed as sent by God for the Hebrew people, the Jewish people, but also for we who are Gentiles, and not just in the first century, but in every century, and not in just a specific geographic place, Israel, but as the universal Savior for all people everywhere. And in the Hebrew context here, in the book of Hebrews, Moses, for 16 centuries at this point, had been the standard bearer. He had given the law. He had founded the nation of Israel. He was the definer of who the priests were through the law of Moses, which said, the descendants of Aaron will be the priesthood of the people of Israel, the Jewish people. But the book of Hebrews is arguing that is past. That is now set aside because a superior priest has come, appointed by God, who has said the oath, "You shall be a priest forever." And that priest is Jesus. He is superior to the priests who came before. And we see how he's superior in this passage as the author delineates it. First, in verses 11 through 19, he is superior to the law. The covenant of Jesus at the cross is superior to the law, meaning the law of Moses, because the law gives no hope, and humans can't keep it anyway. It gives us no hope because we can't keep the law. Verse 11, perfection has not been achieved through a priesthood based on laws. First, there were the Ten Commandments, still in effect in our day. Then there were all the other laws of the priesthood given, ritual law, priesthood law, moral law. And verse 16, a law or a priesthood based on genetics or on historical tradition is not something that will offer hope because it doesn't change the human heart. We cannot obey the law because we have a heart that is sinful. And whatever law we're speaking of, the laws of the state of Massachusetts or Rhode Island or New Jersey or the United States, they change as time goes by. When I was a kid, dating myself here, you couldn't go to a store on Sunday. They were closed. It was against the law to open on Sunday. Then years later, they repealed that, and now everybody's out shopping and everybody's going to the store on Sunday. The law has changed. When I was a kid, the marijuana was illegal. Now in Massachusetts, at least, under a certain amount, it's legal, although under federal law, it's still illegal. It's confusion. And who knows all the laws of the state of Massachusetts? Who knows all the laws of the United States? Nobody does. And whether it's the law of Moses and religious law or the law of the state or the country, it doesn't change the human heart. The laws are trying to say drugs, certain drugs are illegal, and it has done nothing to stop the flow except drive up the price of the illegal drugs that are everywhere on our streets and taking the lives of so many of our young people and older people too. The law has failed. The law shows us that we are sinful because we cannot keep it. None of us can keep all the laws of God or the Ten Commandments or the laws of the state. Only a changed heart can keep God's law, which is a changed heart through Jesus Christ. In the first century, the law that's being written about in Hebrews, there were 613 ceremonial and religious laws that the Jewish people were supposed to keep. The Ten Commandments had then been added to the law of Moses, and the law of Moses had all the laws about how to offer sacrifices, 613, and by the first century when this was written, it had all morphed into thousands of regulations that the average everyday Jewish person on the streets of Israel was supposed to be mindful of. On the Sabbath, if you carry in your hand anything heavier than a dried fig, that's like the weight of a hummingbird, you should not, you have just broken the law because it constitutes work, the rabbi said. And there were all sorts of regulations, how to wash your hands ceremonially, and if you didn't do it perfectly, you had violated God's law. And what happened is the people began to worry more about what their religious leaders had to say, and struggling to keep these man-made laws and worrying about being cast out of the religion for breaking too many of them versus remembering God loves me. God wants me to have faith in him. And so the relationship with God was broken under the weight of trying to keep all these laws and trying to avoid getting in trouble with the religious authorities. We can't keep the law. We can't remember them all. The Ten Commandments are broken in our heart, in daily life. If not in our actions, then in our heart. I was in Kennebunkport, Maine a couple weeks ago, and I was driving along, minding my own business, and a blue light appeared behind me. And I didn't see the sign that the 50-mile-an-hour zone had changed to 35, and I was explaining to an officer that I didn't see it, but yes, I was speeding. I did not get a ticket. He said, it was like 10 o'clock in the morning, he said, have you been drinking? And I burst out laughing. I said, I haven't had a drink since before you were born. But we can't keep the law. We violate the law. We break the law. The law demonstrates that we are fallen, that we are sinful. And the author of Hebrews is agreeing with what the great apostle Paul wrote in Romans 7, verse 19. The good that I wish, I do not do, but I practice the very sin that I would not. What I want to do, I don't do. What I don't want to do is what I end up doing. We're fallen. We're sinful. The law gives no hope because it reveals our fallenness and it offers no way out. There's no cure. You offer a sacrifice, you already owe another before the sacrifice is done. There's no hope found in the law, the author of Hebrews has to say. And the same is true, the author goes on to point out, with religious leaders. Religious leaders. We cannot place our hope in religious leaders for a couple of very important reasons, and we've seen this reasoning in Hebrews before. Religious leaders are mortal. They'll always let us down in some way. And the next point made here is that very thing. For one thing, priests, ministers, rabbis, whatever the title may be, they serve for only a short little amount of time, and then due to death, they're no longer in service. They're here today and gone tomorrow. I'm hoping in my case for a little reprieve about that death thing, but they're here today and then they're gone. There's no exception. And then there's the fact that they're mortal human beings. They offer an offering first for their sin because they're sinful, then they get around to offering an offering for us under the Mosaic system. And then there's the fact that they were only chosen because of who their granddaddy was, Aaron, the brother of Moses. They're chosen by genetics, not because they're of stellar character, but because of who they descend from. It's mentioned in verse 11 and verse 16, the line of the family of Aaron became the priesthood. So they struggle to fulfill the qualifications of the priesthood, and they have to offer an offering for their own sin. They're fallen people, and besides all that, even the longest serving of them are here today, and then they're going to be gone again. A better priest, says Hebrews, is one who would be like the indestructible Melchizedek that we talked about last week in the early part of the chapter. Melchizedek, according to Genesis and according to Hebrews, had no beginning and no end. Was he Shem, the son of Noah? That was an old Jewish idea that that's who it was. And if so, he was 500 years old in Genesis 14 when he met Abraham and accepted a tithe for him and offered a sacrifice for him. Without beginning or ending, the real priest we want to long for and who would fulfill that place in us is indestructible. And Hebrews is saying Jesus fits that. He died on the cross for our sin, the apex, the once and for all sacrifice for sin. But he rose again victorious over death and ascended to heaven, Acts 1 verse 9, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. And here in Hebrews it says he's able to intercede for us generation after generation, forever and ever and ever, because he's alive, not deceased. He had no sin. He needs offer no offering for his own sin. So he's the cure. He's the true priest that we long for, who can fill that empty space, who's always on duty, who is never old and struggling, is never forgetful of who we are, is always aware of every need that we face, has no sin in himself, so he needs not deal with that first. But he's perfect in all of his ways, and he can send the Holy Spirit to work in our life. And if we're among those who hear the call and say, Lord, take me, I want to follow Christ, I want him to be my Savior, he comes into our heart, and then he changes our heart. And we long to do the right thing. And we read the teaching of Jesus, Matthew 5, 6, and 7, the Sermon on the Mount. Read it every day. We see the teaching of Jesus. And because we love God, we need no law to tell us what to do. Because we want to do the right thing. And we want to please him. And we won't take out a gun and shoot our neighbor or rob our neighbor or cheat or lie to our neighbor. Because we love our neighbor. Because we love God. And he's changed our heart. And we need no law. Paul wrote in Galatians, for the fruits of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, and self-control. He said, against such things there is no law. If we're living these things because our heart has changed in Christ and we love God, we need no law to tell us what to do. When I was a kid, like today in the house, we had a wood stove, and beside it was a wood box that my dad had. And every now and then I'd be sitting on the couch and I'd be watching TV or I'd be fooling around doing something. And one of my chores was to bring wood up from the cellar because that's where Dad kept it. I can hear his voice saying, Billy, go down and get the wood and fill up the wood box. And I'd be like groaning and I'd take it and I'd go down the stairs and I had to load the wood in it. And then, you know, I'm 12, 13, 14, I had to carry that wood up the stairs and it felt so heavy. Excuse me. But if it was a cold day and nobody had lit a fire and the room was cold and I got home from school, guess what the first thing I'd do was? I'd grab that basket, I'd run down the stairs, I'd fill it up, I'd bring up the wood, I'd light the fire, and I'd pull my chair over by the stove. Nobody needed to tell me if I wanted to do it, if I was motivated by my own circumstances. If we love God, if we're listening to the teaching of Jesus, we need no law to tell us what to do, because we love our neighbor, because we want to do the next right thing, because we want to live in a way that honors God. So we're going to seek to be, as imperfect as we are, with feet of clay, we're going to seek to be people of character. We're going to seek to be the best that we can be. We need no law to tell us what to do or not to do, because with the law of Christ lives in our heart and we're motivated to please Him, the living high priest who sits at the right hand of the Father, not some priest who is here and then gone or is fallen in some way morally. I heard the latest one just yesterday, another prominent minister who's now been suspended from his church because of some type of stuff he's gotten into that he shouldn't have. Priests will all, ministers, they'll all, religious leaders, they'll always let us down. None of them are perfect, but Christ is. So we live to please Him. We don't need a law to tell us how to behave or how to do the right thing. We're motivated by love for Him to do what pleases Him. We don't need a statute on the books to tell us thou shalt not murder, because we'll love our neighbor and seek what is best for our neighbor and for everyone else. So Hebrews is arguing religious figures, they come and go. The law shows us we are sinful because we can't keep it, but it offers no hope. We have no hope in either of those things, only maybe a temporary good feeling that's here today, gone tomorrow. But Hebrews is presenting the superiority of Jesus, because love for Him and desire to please Him replaces the law. We no longer need a law, and we're following one who will be there every day of our life, always on duty, always listening to us. And lastly, and very importantly, unlike the law of Christ, the covenant of Christ, is eternal and is a covenant of grace. Do you know what the theological definition of grace is? It's the unmerited favor of God. We couldn't keep the law. We don't deserve rewards. But God's grace, His favor, is bestowed on us when we trust in Christ, so we receive an eternal covenant of eternal life and God's favor freely given to us, though we are sinful. Verse 24, His priesthood is eternal. He is able, verse 25, to rescue us and sustain us forever and ever and ever. There's no expiration date on the covenant of Jesus for those, verse 25, who have chosen to draw close to Him, responded to the Holy Spirit, who are walking with Him. And verse 27 is key. He has offered Himself as a sacrifice without need to offer a sacrifice first for His sin, but His sacrifice was effective for our sin and whoever will look to Him by faith for our redemption, our forgiveness forever and ever and ever. His salvation is eternal. His sacrifice is all sufficient, and His covenant is superior, because when we surrender to Him, our heart is changed, we're forgiven completely, and we live to please Him. We live to care for Him. We live to care for one another, and we are eternally rescued by the covenant of Jesus Christ. Hebrews is saying His covenant is superior. The law shows that we need a rescue. The priests are morally fallen and imperfect, but the covenant and person of Jesus is eternal, and He'll never let us down. We'll never read in the paper that He's been suspended from office. He grants eternal life and eternal salvation in a covenant of grace, freely given forgiveness for we lawbreakers who are forgiven and receive His favor, though we do not merit his favor. Forgiveness granted by God out of his rich character toward we who love him, and it's found in the person and work of Jesus Christ. Years ago, Paula Dunn sung here twice. Paula Dunn was a little baby in Bangor, Maine, and her parents were addicted to drugs. And one day there came a knock on the door of their apartment, and two people from a local church were going door to door asking people, is there something we can pray for you for? And they knocked on Paula Dunn's parents' door, and Paula Dunn's parents said, can you take care of this baby while we go out for a while? Well, they took care of that baby for 18 years and raised her. The parents ended up not coming back. When Paula Dunn was in her early 20s, she got a message. Her dad had gotten out of jail and he wanted a relationship with her. And she writes, I had a decision to make. I could choose to forgive him. I could choose to invite him into my life. Or I could avoid the pain of my father being in jail while I was growing up, and I could choose not to forgive him and to keep him out of my life. She reflected on her own situation and how God had forgiven her through Jesus Christ, and therefore she should forgive others. And so she allowed her father into her life. She forgave him for not being there as she was growing up. And she shared the hope that she had in Christ with him. Her heart was changed. She needed no law to do what she knew was the next right thing and to please God by the choices she made in how she lived her life. Hebrews is saying to us, don't trust in rituals. Don't trust in the ceremonies or in churches or in the laws that are created by people, though we need them in society, certainly. But trust in Christ, because he will change our hearts and we'll no longer need all those laws to tell us what to do. We will, in our heart, love him and long to please him. And the Ten Commandments are all the laws that we need to tell us what God's pleasure is and his desires are. And we will trust in Christ, who is superior. He will never be fallen. He will never disappoint. And he will grant us his grace, his unmerited favor, unto life eternal in his kingdom. No matter who we are, no matter what we've done, there is hope in him, the great high priest who lives forever and ever. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this word. We thank you for this truth and this hope that you give us through your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you that he and his covenant are superior to any other religious covenant or any other religious law. Thank you that he is greater than any priest, for he lives forever and he will never fail us. And thank you, Heavenly Father, that by trusting in him, our hearts are changed. So we'll love to do the right thing. We'll love to know the mind of God and what pleases him, and we will live to do that. So help us to take these steps and follow Christ and give our heart and life to him, in whose name we pray. Amen. We have communion this morning, and our worship team is going to lead us in a song of communion.
If you'll stand and sing with us.
Thought about the superiority of the covenant of Jesus, which is made up of his person. It's not a religion, it's a relationship with him. And his covenant is based on his sinless life and his sacrifice on the cross, where he gave his body and allowed his blood to be shed for the remission, for the forgiveness, the washing away of our sin. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved you that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life." We're thinking about and remembering the covenant of Jesus and his sacrifice for us as represented by the elements this morning. I'm going to invite us to take a moment of silent prayer between ourselves and God, reflecting on his sacrifice, perhaps giving thanks for what he has done on our behalf. Father, it is out of your grace and mercy that you sent your Son Jesus into the world, who had been God the Son for all eternity. And yet he took on human form and walked about like an ordinary man, and then allowed himself to be nailed to the cross and gave his life for our sin. Father, make this real to us. Plant him in our heart. Help us to live for him, so that we need no correction, we need no law, but only the law of love for you. As we remember him today, we remember with gratitude what he has done for us. With thankful hearts, in the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. On the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Eat this in remembrance of me." In the same manner, Jesus took the cup and said, "This cup is my blood poured out in a new covenant for you. Drink this in remembrance of me." A lot easier to open, weren't they? We've gone back to the other kind. Thank you for being here today to worship the Lord together, to express your gratitude to him, to reflect on his noble character, his eternal person, and for Jesus, our great high priest, who right now, is sitting at the right hand of the Father, interceding on our behalf forever and ever and ever. May the grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be yours in abundance. Amen.